Alright.
Oh, nice cookies, thanks again. Wushu, dinawe magetuk, mama relatives, kinesi kwen, jinakas, makwa, nodeem, gababani ka, geshkana, gininim, dunjuba. From the White Earth Reservation, a little bit northwest of here. And a lot of the people know me because I testified at almost every immature, and all these guys were kind of old pals now. I didn't get on the Enbridge party bus yet though. You let me know when you're gonna let me on the Enbridge party bus, and I'll see what it looks like in there. But we came in on our own party bus today, which was a horse and carriage. Sorry, we did not use your petroleum to get here. That was pretty cool. Anyway, I don't intend to make a lot of comments.
Say it, wait a little bit.
Oh, go like this, don't boom it.
Yeah,
better.
You're too close.
Better. Janet's a very hardworking woman. I got a lot of respect for her. I want to say I don't intend to make a lot of huge comments. I intend to ask a few questions, because this is the time when we ask our questions, and I started earlier this afternoon. But I wanted to make a couple of overview comments. So a couple things. I'm like the rest of you. I have lived my entire life in the petroleum era. I had a pretty good time. You guys all have a pretty good time. I get the whole thing of we all use oil. I get that. We all do. You know, we've lived there. I went to the drive-in movie. I did all kinds of cool stuff, right?
Yeah.
Get flowers from Columbia same day, New York Times. Sometimes that's super cool. It's like, wow. You understand what I'm saying? It's like, I get that we're there. But what I want is a graceful and elegant transition out of it. Because the fact is that what remains in the petroleum era is going to kill us. If the remaining oil that is there, you've got to either blow up the bedrock of Mother Earth and frack it so that you destroy the water and the air with a bunch of benzene in North Dakota. Or you've got to mine an area the size of Florida up in the Athabasca River Basin and turn it into a poison waste full of filth that kills people and animals in the air and life when everything is dead. Or you gotta go drill in the Arctic in these people's village, 20,000 feet under the ocean, and pretend that that's gonna work out. You've entered an era that is so extreme in your behavior that we're at a point when we need to look at our addiction and figure out how to transition away from it, because it is incredibly, incredibly dangerous. So I say that with all recognition of the situation we're all in. I get it. We're all here together. I'm an Anishinaabe person. That is my nationhood, but I also live in the state of Minnesota, and I would like a regulatory system in the state of Minnesota that was mature, that was elegant, and that made sense, and that was not at the behest of a Canadian corporation. The other thing I want to say about that petroleum era is that the reason I know it's going to end is this little efficiency thing. Earlier on, people talked about solar energy and electric cars. And I can't remember if it was our pal here, but a couple people said that. You know, what I want to say about that, and maybe the Aiken County commissioners, you know, it'd be super awesome if you guys would listen to some broader, just get out a little bit. Listen to some different opinions, it might help. I'm just going to say this with all love for you, because I live in Becker County. I spent a lot of time in Hubbard, Clearwater, Winona County. Sometimes we just live right there and we don't know what's going on. Okay, so we're driving these cars. And the fact is that the engine of a car, a combustion engine, is 16% efficient. For every 6 gallons of gas, you only 1 gallon is all that actually moves your vehicle. It's super, super inefficient way to move things around. And that's what we've been doing. But enlightened and intelligent societies like ours, or like crafty people from Germany, or like Mr. Tesla, have moved beyond that. The things like the electric engine. Now it turns like that, that an electric engine is 65% efficient. That's a lot more efficient than the 16% efficiency of a combustion engine. So we're at this moment, all of us, everybody in the room, including Enbridge, with a $4 billion wind portfolio and a very large solar portfolio, that we could move into the next energy economy, the one that will not combust us to oblivion or put oil and toxins in our water and rice. It is this moment where all of us in humanity could do this. And it is absolutely this moment in Minnesota. That's kind of like this overarching thought I have, which is kind of like, let's grow up together. Let's move to the next economy together, instead of trying to figure out how we're going to poison ourselves and how fast it will be. and what our options are in the poisoning, because that seems like a really stupid way to live. And it's certainly an insane way to make public policy. Like, should we shoot ourselves in the head with a pipeline, or should we just wait till a train explodes our town? What kind of choices are those for an intelligent society? They're not good choices. So that is the first thing I wanted to say. The second thing I wanted to say is really about the structural position we are in. You know, I spent a lot of time in school. I've been on the streets a lot. I've been around a lot. I'm super privileged. I understand that. I have heard and been with great political leaders. I met Nelson Mandela. That's one cool cat. You know what I'm saying? Bobby Kennedy Jr. I've seen some intelligent human beings that think about things. You know, Vandana Shiva. And what I'm saying is that we're at this moment where what has happened is that the state of technology and the economics of the system and the driving forces of fossil fuels economy, or the nuclear economy, or the military economy for all that, are far ahead of our ability to regulate them. So you got crazy things going on. In this country, you have this thing called the Halliburton Amendment, which made it possible to frack without being compliant with the Clean Water Air Act, the Clean Air Act, the Safe Drinking Water Act, or any of the federal environmental laws. Tar sands oil is totally unregulated. These guys are unregulated, and it's a rogue industry. We are not regulating for future generations like this beautiful, beautiful young man who stood here. He said the most intelligent things of any of us. I want to be able to drink the water. I want to be able to rise. I want to be able to hunt. I want to be able to live as an Anishinaabe person. That is all we are asking, which is pretty much all everybody is asking. But we as Anishinaabe, we have no place else to go. This is the place in the world the Creator put us, where the wild rice is. This is the place the Creator gave us. This is our remaining territory. And as our attorney said, this we intend to fight for because this is all we have in the world. We cannot move someplace else. Enbridge can move anywhere. They are not a person. They are not a nation of people. They're a Canadian oil transportation company. They don't need to be here. They don't need to be asking us for favors. They don't need to be demanding our land and our water and our future to compromise it. You know, so I look at this and I know where we are. And I'm saying, and Jamie, these are some questions I'm gonna have to ask you, and you know, with all due respect, I know you've had a tough week, you know, and we met early in the week. So we have a structural problem in the PUC process from what I can figure. I observed your slides, PowerPoint, as you presented them before. You still have a date of September or the fall of 2016 for the completion of a process. But what is clear, that is what it says that you plan to be completed with the process by then. So what is clear from our previous questions and the questions we have asked a couple of times is one, you don't have a way to make an assessment of how bad the damages are on line three, the present environmental impact of line three, before you allow the company that has created a giant mess with 900 structural anomalies and leaks throughout the line to move someplace else. A little bit of the cart before the horse there. You know, it seems super baffling to me. Two, why you keep having this thing up here that says September 16th when I know, September, you know, in 16, 2016 when you get this done, when I know that the Enbridge is telling the Army Corps of Engineers that they plan to begin construction in 2017. Why does Enbridge drive your agenda when you don't have a regulatory process which either does tribal consultation, as we said before, nor does it have a plan to complete an assessment of line three prior to this? Now, I know that you're just conducting the information meetings, but this is the questions that we have to ask you. The third question I have to ask you in the regulatory process, are you okay with me asking three at once?
We can break them down again.
Okay. Otherwise, it's gonna go back and forth, your choice.
Go ahead, ask the third one.
Okay, the third one. Then I got a few questions from the gentleman here. The third question I have is, okay, it says we, Minnesota citizens, Anishinaabe people, must come up with a route that gets from Clearbrook to Superior. Why do we have to do that? Because it is assumed that they will have perpetual need for their pipeline. Why does the public have to come up with the route for the corporation? Why must all our comments fulfill their need? Why must they not prove to us with the reduced price of oil that in world markets that there is a need, since Minnesota's need has actually diminished? You know, why must they not prove to us that there is a need? Why we have to go in and come up with the route that meets their specifications? Why is that the burden of the public? So that's the first three questions I have, and you know, with all due respect, Jamie, because this is the question time. So, and I've been through this. This is not my first rodeo with you guys.
All right, let's start with the third question.
The cookies.
The need for this project has not been determined.
Wow.
We don't have determination on that. And I would say in regards to developing route and segment alternatives, that's an opportunity. No one is saying you have to do that. It's an opportunity for everyone here and in all these meetings to develop or propose a route or segment alternative. What I can say is that at Enbridge, they get to, based on the rule, they get to determine what their preferred route is. And if you individually or collectively don't like the route that has been presented, you have this opportunity to say, I think we should do something else. So that's the purpose of allowing everyone the opportunity to come up with alternatives to this. It's not saying that Enbridge has the perfect route. It's saying either we don't agree with this or we think there's another way we could route this pipeline. Of course, that's assuming that a pipeline is needed. And I'm not going to debate whether or not that's needed. That's not for me to determine. So,
I mean, back to that initial, if this need is not determined for this pipeline, why are we having a discussion about a route? Why does Enbridge not have to prove that it has a continued need for a line 3?
Well, at this point, the need and the routing process are kind of going together. That's how these...
How does that function?
That's a question.
Jamie, can I jump in?
You are from the PUC. I'm asking a state official, my state official, to explain to me a regulatory process. If Enbridge would like to explain why it runs the regulatory process, that might be a different question. But I'm asking my state to tell me why this process is functional, and I think she's asking Mr. Eck to assist her.
Yes, I'm asking Mr. Eck.
Hello, Mr. Eck.
Good evening. My name is Scott Eck. I'm with the Public Utilities Commission. So if I have this correct, you're questioning the processes. Okay, we have two processes, the Certificate of Need, which is one process. We have the routing process. That process is a process that helps the state determine where the route should go. At this point, we have the rules, 27853, Certificate of Need, 7852, routing. Now, those rules are made by your legislature as state employees for the Department of Commerce, for the Public Utilities Commission. We have to follow those rules. We can't change those rules. They're made by the legislature. So first, I would say, if you don't like those rules and you want changes, that's something that needs to go to the legislature. Now, with the rules that we're following tonight, we're primarily here tonight for the routing, and they are going together right now. And this is very typical of a transmission line project, a pipeline project. Sometimes companies will actually apply for the route before they apply for the certificate of need. And we can go through that whole route process, and a determination cannot be made until, so, if you get to the end of the route process, the commission cannot make a determination on routing. So it stops until, if that project needs a certificate of need determination, then we go back and we have to wait for that whole CN process. That's if they're flip-flopped. And they can be, and it has happened that way for other projects. So it would have to wait until a need determination. Now, if the commission says, well, that project's not needed, all that time was wasted for rubbing. And that's on the company. They're paying the permitting fees for that whole process, so it's their gamble which way they want to go. As this process is going, they are going together. The routing, which we're here primarily tonight for, is the opportunity for people to inform the environmental document. And that environmental document is the CEA, Comparative Environmental Analysis. That is part of the routing process. And what we're asking people to do is provide us with information on what is problematic, or what they see as problematic with the route that was proposed by Enbridge. What are those environmental problems? Where are those sensitive areas? What do you want the Department of Commerce to study in the environmental document? And then, and to actually, it's an information meeting as well to explain the process, to explain the project, and so forth. So what will happen now is once these meetings are over, the comment period is closed, I believe September 30th, DOC will go back, and as it stands, they'll put together a scope for that CEA. They will be coming back to the commission. I don't have an exact timeline for you. Oh, and I can get to timelines too. I believe you brought that up, but I don't have a timeline. I think it was 90 days from the last order, and I'm sorry if I don't have, so that I think it puts it into November, and don't hold me to that because schedules change. The commission at that time will decide whether to continue with the routing process. They haven't referred routing to the Office of Administrative Hearings. So the routing process could, depending on their decision, be halted, just like Sandpiper was. The CN has already been referred, and that is continuing to proceed right now. The CN process doesn't have information meeting like this. They will go through the process, and there will be the public hearings, similar to what Sandpiper was, when we had like 6 months, 8 months ago. I know it's complicated, and the rules aren't easy to follow, and that's unfortunate. And I know it's confusing for folks. I tell you what, it gets confusing for us.
I don't know which of you to ask the next question, but I have a couple other things, and you know, there's a lot of other people that want to talk, so I get that. So you were saying that in 90 days, you're going to complete a comparative environmental assessment.
No.
Okay, that was totally.
I believe in the order, they'll come back with the scope. That's essentially what the comparative environmental analysis will look at. It's kind of the table of contents of what will be looked at. The commission will look that over, and I'm not quite sure at this point.
And so, at what point will the full assessment of the present state of line 3 and the 900 structural anomalies and the 4,000 projected digs be included in the environmental assessment of the project?
I don't know. That will be determined when the scope comes out after this comment period has ended. And
okay.
If that's been brought up right now.
I think it's been brought up a number of times, and I guess, Mr. Eck, with all due respect, I feel like the state of Minnesota is facing 4 large oil pipelines. That the energy, the largest of the Enbridge company and the Koch brothers are basically dictating a timetable with which they are hoping to get completed. And they have pipes laying on the corners of my reservation right now, which is causing our community a lot of duress.
That's what I was going to get to, the timelines that you brought up.
Right.
Those come straight from our rules. There are definitions within the rules for these time periods, these milestones in the process. And so when those are big estimates that we've thrown out there, trust me, they were put across my desk, and I was a little wary. I said these are estimates, so make people know that, because as we've seen with Sandpiper, this process has changed, and it's gone past what's written in rule, and the commission has made changes to allow more public process, to allow more commenting, which has extended the timelines to where it's hard for us to predict sometimes.
Right, thank you. I have one other question for you, and then I have some questions for the gentleman of Enbridge, and then a couple of just closing comments. So, my understanding is that you guys, Department of Commerce, and earlier, I'll ask you another question on this, but have taken over the environmental assessment from the MPCA. That the environmental assessment, the alternative environmental assessment is going to be done by the Department of Commerce.
The comparative environmental analysis.
And so how many employees do you have in the Department of Department of Commerce that are going to do this study?
We will be working with a consultant team to complete the document.
So you're going to hire some consultants to complete the document on a oil pipeline or a couple of oil pipelines. You're going to put 1.4 million barrels a day of oil across our land. You're going to hire some consultants to do that.
That would be correct.
That would be correct. And so the Minnesota Public, the Minnesota Pollution Control Agency with 950 employees who is paid by the state is not going to be involved in that because you guys are hiring some consultants. Is that right?
No, that's incorrect, actually. We will be preparing the document and working with consultants on that. We will also be coordinating with other state agencies, including MPCA and Minnesota DNR.
Right, but in the last hearings we all just went through, their testimony was entirely discredited and diminished, and your testimony was a more significant testimony.
That's a matter of opinion. Would not.
Well, that's what you wouldn't say.
No, I attended those hearings and I would not say that their testimony was discounted.
But you're the lead agency.
Correct.
Okay. So that was just, you know, one set of questions I had on that. And we talked prior, but you have not figured out your process for tribal consultation. In your slideshow here, you had tribes listed as participating in your public process. We are not people. Tribal governments do not participate in your public process. Tribal governments are governments. And you have listed them. So again, is there any point that you guys are planning to have formal meetings with tribal governments or to begin to talk to them? When would that occur? So that I can inform people and we can know about that.
Well, first is we have discussed previously that neither the Department of Commerce nor the Public Utilities Commission has a tribal liaison per se, as other state agencies like Minnesota DNR does.
So you have no tribal liaison?
That's correct.
And so how will these discussions between our tribal governments, our 1855 treaty authority, or 1854 treaty authority, or, you know, Cliffwick, how will those occur if you don't have a tribal liaison and you have a timetable that is already up there?
Cliffwick is certainly, they can comment on this. Anyone is able to comment on this.
But that does not qualify as consultation with the nation.
I'm not saying that that does qualify as consultation. I am simply saying that as a legal matter, that is not something that I can address at this meeting.
So at what point will we get the answer to that? I know that you have here where you can get asked these same questions in 2 days, and it would be really groovy if we could get some sense of how the Department of Commerce is going to address the fact that they don't have a tribal liaison.
Yeah.
No, yeah.
We have, if you look at the order that was put up to, I think August 4th, that was put up, the commission understands and is quite aware of the concern about tribal consultation. It's in the order, and that order must be followed. It's part of this process, and if it's pointed out that item in the order hasn't been followed, then there's a big argument there. In Department of Commerce's defense, in Public Utilities Commission's defense, I'm not quite sure yet how we've figured out how that process is going to go. I have not talked to anybody. I don't have that capacity. I don't believe Jamie does either. And you understand that we're not, you know, at the top of the ladder here. I can tell you it's known, the commissioners are all very aware very well aware that it needs to happen. They're well aware of the letters that have been sent in. So it's on the radar. I can't give you specifics on how we know that might happen.
So, you know, part of what I'm dealing with is that I'm a pretty intelligent person, and I know my history. And I know that in 1889, the state of Minnesota has basically screwed us at every turn. Burning people out of their houses over here in the 1930s, taking our land. All of Aiken County was carved out of Indian territory. You know, time after time. And this is not 1889, this is 2015. And so I'm asking for a mature tribal government, or a mature state government, to deal with a mature tribal government that's been here for a very long time in the state of Minnesota. And I'm wondering what the tribes have asked you specifically, and I've been party and privy to that, is to put a moratorium on these proceedings until you figure out how to talk to us.
I understand your concern. Unfortunately, this is the wrong venue.
This is the place where we are allowed to ask questions. It's the only place
that I've talked. This is the place to ask questions about the proposed project. You're talking about a process question. We're not capable, us two folks here, of answering that. We can bring this to the attention of our commissioners. You can bring this to the attention of the commissioners. I believe some letters have been sent in to Governor Dayton as well. I understand. The purpose of tonight is to provide comment on the environmental document. Unfortunately, it's not the venue to discuss how procedurally the Department of Commission or the Public Utilities Commission, we can't answer that, us folks here.
Okay.
And so it does need to go to the commissioners.
Okay.
It needs to go to the top people.
With all due respect, sir, having been at many hearings, and you know this, I know that there is not an opportunity to ask this question at any hearing. In fact, you're allowed to testify for 3 minutes and you're not allowed to get answers. And previously, when we asked questions a couple of days ago, the fine gentleman from Enbridge, we were told not to ask those questions, but we didn't finally push ahead with some of the questions. So what I'm saying is that the question of process actually precedes the question of which part of the environment we're fighting over protecting or which part gets screwed. You know, that's part of what we're asking here. And I feel like it is the place to ask it. It is the place to put it out, because I am saying, with all due respect, we have a public policy crisis in the state of Minnesota. I want public policy that works, not for foreign oil transportation companies, but for the people of Minnesota and the Ojibwe of Minnesota. I want to trust my state to do the right thing for me. I don't want to raise my blood pressure every time I go talk to y'all, and I don't want to think that you guys think that it's still 1889 and not 2015.
That's understood, and I understand. Again, this is not the venue to be asking process questions about our Minnesota rules on how they were created by the legislature, how our departments work. We are here simply to inform the public of the project, of this process as it's written. I'm sorry, but I can't give you specifics on you know, those process questions that you would like to see. I don't have the ability.
Okay. With all due respect, Mr. Eck, I understand your position, and I'm saying that this is a crisis in Minnesota. You're asking us to participate in an extremely dysfunctional process and act as if the process works. And that is a waste of the time of people in Minnesota if your process doesn't work. And so it's really, really important, because there's a light that is shining on Minnesota, because you guys are the epicenter of it. And it is really important that you talk to the people upstairs, but also that we figure out together how to make public policy that works in Minnesota. I have a real big interest in having it, and I understand your response, but I also understand this is informational meetings. We are asking questions. You give me timetable. I ask you why the timetable looks like that, why these things are omitted from the timetable. That would seem like the things you would ask in an informational session. So, you know, you guys take a breath. I'm not gonna, you know, chase you down with my wheelchair. Okay. You know, I got some other questions for you guys, gentlemen. I'm sorry, you're not getting off the hook. So, first of all, the fine gentleman, yes, you, who is in charge, I believe, I forgot your name, what's your name?
John.
Okay, John, I understand that you, I believe that you are in charge of, what was it called, like making the right-of-way look good again. Right-of-way restoration. Who's the right-of-way restoration guy? That's you, right?
I work with landowner concerns about the restoration of the right-of-way after the project is nearing completion.
So, do you work at all on that Light 3 with all those structural anomalies in it?
Currently, I am involved with major projects. I have a history working with Enbridge in operations, though that particular component is handled through Enbridge operations, but I am familiar with integrity digs that you're referring to.
And so how is that getting resolved? Because you guys need a new pipeline because you got so many, right?
I think that particular question is more related to engineering side because of the condition of the pipe, so probably we'll be able to hand that over to fire service.
I'm just going to share with Mike.
Do you mind repeating the question?
Well, I asked him first because it wasn't clear. Like, I've appreciated you guys all introduce yourselves. But, you know, if you're in charge of, like, beautifying right-of-way restoration, you know, I mean, you know, maybe there's a separate question I should ask you, which is, like, how you restore a wild rice bed. Maybe that's what I should just ask you. Can you tell me how you do that? I'm sorry, now you have to pass it back to him. That's probably a better question for him. You get the 900 in a second, but.
Well, this is a partial job here, and so John is in charge of land services, and what that includes is dealing with the landowners and addressing their concerns through the process of restoration. He doesn't physically do the restoration work. His department doesn't physically do that work. The issue of if oil got into a rice lake and affected a rice bed, destroyed a rice bed, it wouldn't necessarily be land, it wouldn't necessarily be this team here, it would be part of our emergency response team, and it is not something that Enbridge has had to do. We have not had to work on a rice lake after oil has gotten into it. I don't believe there's been any contamination like that that I know of. However, I'll let Barry talk in a second, but as I understand it through the scope of the CEA, that is part of the analysis. There is discussion in there about spills, or there will be discussions in there about spills and about responses and about the effect on the environment as well as the cleanup. So it will be part of the CEA, and we'll be happy to provide the information that we can. So as of right now, I don't think we have the right person here to really answer that or the experience.
Let me
one on Barry Simonson. One thing I might want to address though is the first part that we strive for at Enbridge is prevention. So if you're speaking of the new Line 3 that we're proposing, because you're talking about wild rice beds, if the first question was talking about the integrity digs, correct?
Right, that is right.
Okay, so first of all, in terms of, and I'm not in the operations group, but I'm part of MP, but we do work in unison with our operations group. Based on our integrity management program that's in place through operations, they have found anomalies on that existing Line 3, which was placed in service back in the 1960s. And by use of those smart tools we talked about earlier, which Enbridge is on the forefront in the technology realm with that, they do find those areas that may be in question. Now, those areas are usually on public and private land because that's where the pipeline traverses. So when those areas are needed for investigation, landowners are contacted. Access is provided either by an access road that's existing off an existing right-of-way from a road, and we treat those anomaly digs just like we would with construction itself with regard to topsoil stripping if needed, excavating down on the pipelines in a safe manner, matting over the existing lines or any utilities that might be present in order to get to the pipe and figure out what the issue may be and fix the issue. And then restoration is conducted as it would be with normal pipeline construction, with backfilling and then topsoil back and restoration.
Thank you for answering. That was interesting. My question is a little bit more specific and prior to a leak. The fact is that this is a very delicate aquatic ecosystem up here. You have lakes, you have creeks, you have wild rice, you have places where our cranberries are, you have places where our tamaracks and our other medicines are. It's very delicate. If you put a pipeline or a set of pipelines through that delicate ecosystem where water moves in subsurficial aquifers, moves through creeks, moves through the bogs, you change the movement of that water. And in the case of wild rice, I'm talking about even before a spill. So when you do that, how are you going to restore it before you do it? I mean, you've got this little right-of-way restoration thing. How are you going to restore a wild rice bed? How do you know how to do that? How do you restore a wild rice bed?
Well, that's not
crickets. Explain how we're damaging the wild rice bed by putting the pipeline. You're not talking about a spill, right?
Yeah, this is prior to a spill.
The other thing I want to mention too, is that we are in consultation with the Minnesota Department of Natural Resources for permits, which Mr. Turner can answer in more specifics than I can, as well as the Corps of Engineer and the Pollution Control Agency. So with that, planning for construction, we have certain installation methods that are preferred and alternate that are approved via the permit through the Department of Natural Resources and the agencies I just noted. So part of that is the planning process for construction.
Okay, thank you. I'm not gonna go too much further on this, but I just wanna make a note for the record. I guess you're the record, my dear, that the Minnesota Department of Natural Resources has a vested interest in diminishing the number of rice pits in the state of Minnesota. Because what they're trying to do is not regulate sulfate. And they're trying to count the number of rice pits there and only regulate the rice pits that they actually have listed. So if they make them disappear with a pipeline project, or if they just don't count them because they didn't bother to inventory them, then they don't have to protect them from sulfate contamination. So the Ojibwe tribes do not actually have a lot of faith in the state of Minnesota's process of trying to ascertain on rice pits. I got just one more comment question, and then I'm gonna close up, because I know that there are other people I'd like to hear speak besides myself, because I bore myself as well. So I was listening to the thing on the PSIs. You know, I get that. A lot of pressure per square inch going through. And I know you guys do a lot of testing, and I totally get that Enbridge would like to be the corporation that doesn't have a leak. I get that, because it doesn't help you. You know, we don't want you to have a leak either. We don't want any leaks, except for that the Scientific American reports that you have a 57% chance of a catastrophic leak. You know, so that's not so great for those of us who actually live here. But having said that, in all of your new tests, you and I know, I'm gonna make a leap of faith that you know, that tar sands oil is much more caustic and corrosive than anything that has been going through Line 3 in the past historically. When we moved to tar sands oil, then we got everything breaking down much more rapidly because it's super corrosive. So how are you figuring the PSIs over time with a pure tar sands oil run? That's my first question to you, because I'm not feeling too secure in your answers of the 2100 or 1600 PSIs. How long is this line projected to live? If you have a 60-year-old line, is this a 20-year-old line you're talking about putting in?
Well, I think you had a few questions in there.
I sure did.
I did. Okay.
This, you guys don't answer these questions at the evidence you're hearing, so I gotta ask a few of them.
No, that's fine. In terms of, there's two ways of looking at a pipeline length expectancy. There's one for the business case, and there's one for the actual physical life.
Okay.
Now, depending upon the commitments from shippers and producers, a pipeline business life can be between 25 to 100 years. We've been in operation in Minnesota since 1949 with our existing Enbridge corridor. So that all fluctuates. Now, with the new technologies that we have with pipeline steel strength, with coatings, with hydro testing, with all of the preventive measures that we make, the pipeline itself can be, a lifetime can be an indefinite based on the factors I've mentioned between design, engineering, construction, quality, but also in terms of integrity management going forward for the pipeline itself.
Okay. I don't believe you. I just want to say that. Okay. Thank you for your comments. I want to thank you all for your time. I really had to get a little clarity because I've been to a lot of hearings. There's a lot of questions that we haven't had answers.
The other thing I want to put on the record is that we have been operating our pipelines with oil sands as well as Bakken crude. There is no corrosiveness of the pipelines that we install based on the products that we do operate our pipeline systems with in those pipeline systems in the U.S. and North America.
Thank you.
I have a question for you regarding...
Oh my gosh.